My name is Stephen Reiner. I'm with the Alan Alda Center for Communicating Science at Stony Brook University. This is Science on Tap. Welcome. Today we have one of the world's great time travelers with us. Paul Sorensen is a physicist at Brookhaven National Laboratory, and we're going to travel back in time with Paul. We're not going to go back to the Wild West or to the Renaissance, and we're not going to go back in time in a tricked-out DeLorean. We instead are going to go back 13.8 billion years, if you can imagine. And the device we're going to take a ride on with Paul is about a 2.5 mile loop-de-loop racetrack, which is not that many miles away from here, underneath the ground. So I'm going to ask Paul, why are you trying to go back in time?
Well, if you look out at the cosmos, you look at all the galaxies and everything that are out there, you see that they're all moving away from each other. And so if you rewind the clock and you go back in time, you realize there was a time when all of this stuff that we can see in the universe must have been sitting on top of each other. And we want to know what that stuff was. What was the universe like when it was very young and very hot?
Now, when we imagine the universe we can see,
yes.
When we say imagine, it really is unimaginably vast. It's beyond comprehension. Yet the time we're going to go back to, the universe, as we discussed, might have been about as big as a golf ball.
That's right. There was a time that we understand where the universe was maybe about the size of a golf ball, and then it exploded due to something called inflation. What that basically means is that, you know, we think about things exploding. Usually you're thinking about something exploding into space. But in this case, it's actually space that was expanding. And so all of a sudden, you took a thing that was the size of a golf ball, and you made it the size of our solar system, right? In a very short amount of time. And so everything that was happening, all the little vibrations, and then all the little things in there that were happening, got stretched out to this size. And so we're looking at the time when the universe, that everything that we can see, everything out there, was about the size of our solar system, which is big. But the known universe is something like 94 billion, you know, what we can see is something like 94 billion light years. It's huge. It's a big number. I don't know exactly how to describe it as anything other than just ginormous. But the point is that the universe at that time was a lot more dense and a lot hotter than it is now. So the universe at that time was roughly the density that you would have if you took the entire Earth and you packed it inside Yankee Stadium.
Okay. Crowded.
Crowded, yes. Exactly. It's a very crowded.
How do we know that? How do we know that? Did we have to go back in time to find that out, or that was a hypothesis we wanted to explore?
We know that just by looking into the sky, for the most part. So when you look out at the cosmos, you can see all the things that are left over from that explosion. And we measure all of these things, which can only be made sense of if that is what happened. So first of all, you look out and you see that the universe is expanding. And so the natural thing is to think that, well, if you just go backwards, it must have been smaller. And then you say, well, if I did go backwards and it was smaller, what would happen? Well, it would be more dense and it would be hotter. And if it was more dense and it was hotter, what would happen? And then you start checking all of those things that you expected to happen. And that's what you see. So it ends up that you do find out that, yeah, okay, this must be what was going on. So, but what we want to do is we want to go back and do something where we could recreate the conditions that existed at that very early moment. And to do that, we take very heavy nuclei, the nuclei out of very heavy atoms, and we smash them together.
Well, let's start back with an atom.
Okay.
An atom's a pretty small thing. How small is an atom? Give
Indeed.
Us an idea. Compare an atom to something else.
There are something like 10 to the 28th power of them in our body, which is something like 1 trillion, trillion, trillion of them,
okay.
If I did my math right. Okay. And so if you like smashed yourself into that many pieces, then you would have an atom in each one. Another way to think of it is, you know, it's, oh, I don't have another way to think of it. It's small.
It's smaller than a golf ball.
It's very small.
Lots of atoms in a golf ball.
That's right.
So you start with an atom and then you go inside the atom.
Yeah, that's right. Now, The atom, you can say it's small. Everything is relative. You know, an atom is small. But if you took an atom, and I'm going to go back to Yankee Stadium now. If you took an atom the size of Yankee Stadium, inside that atom, 99% of the mass in the atom would be contained in the nucleus, which would be the size of a football at the center of the stadium. So almost all of the mass of the atom, all of the mass of what makes up us, you know, what makes up our mass, is contained inside this tiny little dense thing at the middle of this big vacuum void of what we call an atom. So the nucleus is extremely dense.
So you get to that nucleus now.
That's right. Now we take two of those things, two of those nuclei. Well, we actually take hundreds of billions of them. But anyway, just imagine two of them. And you speed them both up to very close to the speed of light, so fast that they can go around that, you know, 2.5 mile track in about 10,000 times per second.
Now, how do you do that? How do you shoot them out of a gun? Do you have one of those big springs and you pull it like a pinball machine?
We have a step-by-step facility which starts out just by accelerating them a little bit and injecting them somewhere else. It's all based on sort of like the idea of surfing and waves. So if you get something that's, you know, zooming around in a circle, it goes in a circle because there's a magnetic field, and when a charged particle goes through a magnetic field, it turns. If you get it zooming around, it comes around. Every time it comes around again, there's like an electric field, which gives it a kick. Boom. And it goes around again.
Now, this
boom.
Is called
it keeps going faster and faster and faster. Yes.
This is called the relativistic high ion.
Heavy ion, yeah.
Heavy ion collider, RIC, for sure.
That's right. Yeah.
Relativistic means it goes almost the speed of light.
Exactly. 99.9% the speed of light.
And, of course, the collider, they're smashing.
Yeah, they're smashing.
And the ion is literally what's being smashed into
another. This is where it gets interesting. Like, why an ion? So what you're doing is you're taking a very heavy atom, like we were saying, like gold or uranium. We've done copper, different kinds of atoms. But anyway, you get rid of all the electrons, which are this big diffuse cloud sitting out around, you know, in the cheap seats at Yankee Stadium. And you just have that really dense thing that's left over. And the reason that we start with that is because we're trying to recreate these extremely high densities. And so the trick to doing that is starting out with something that's already very dense. And so nature gave us this nucleus, which allows us to get a long way already to creating that density. But now if you take and you accelerate them up to very high speeds and you smash them into each other, now you can imagine they're going to pass through each other like that. And now you're going to at least have twice the density that you had before, plus all of the energy that comes from the fact that they're going very close to the speed of light. Now you've got the density that you need to go back in time 13.8 billion years ago.
So these two ions collide.
Yes.
They now, do. What's inside the ions? What's locked? Because
that's right.
They're colliding.
That's a good question.
Something is trapped inside those ions, sort of.
It is. There's, first of all, the nuclei, the ions, they're protons and neutrons. So you can think of them as like a bag of marbles, okay? In the case of gold, it's 197 marbles with two different kinds of colors.
Which
they're called protons
heavy.
And neutrons. Yeah, heavy. Uranium, it's 238 marbles. So you think of these two bags of marbles. Now, those marbles are not fundamental particles. They're actually made of other things, okay? So the marbles are the protons and neutrons. But inside the proton and neutron are what we understand to be the fundamental particles, which are things called quarks and gluons.
So if you keep on going deeper and deeper and deeper to what we believe are the fundamental particles of matter, gluons and quarks.
That's right, gluons and quarks. And I want to tell you one quick
thing. There's a reason gluons are called gluons, and you're going to tell us that.
I can tell you, yes. What's really interesting about gluons and quarks is that the way that they behave is the reason we have the mass we do. 95% of our mass comes just from the way that quarks are interacting with the gluons inside the proton and the neutron. Okay, so understanding these interactions is extremely important to understanding us, to understanding our universe, and to understanding what we're made of.
Okay? And this is deep within the atom already. We've gone
that's
beyond
deep
that.
Inside the atom, exactly. And so that's what, you know, distinguishes what is done at these big accelerators from a lot of other science where, you know, you might be playing with a microscope that you're trying to look as deep as you can inside, you know, the atoms and the way that they arrange themselves and what happens if you arrange atoms in different structures, they become molecules. How can you make electronics out of those molecules? We're going a layer or two deeper in nature than that.
So now we've got the ions. Inside of them are these quarks,
yes,
which are kind of held together, glued together by the gluons.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're smashed at these extraordinary speeds, almost the speed of light.
Yeah, that's right.
And what happens?
All hell breaks loose. So you have these things that come in. They're coming at the speed of light. And it's very good to just like show this as like two hands clapping, because the fact that it's relativistic means that relativity is extremely important. And some of you might know the special theory of relativity, which tells you that if something is moving very quickly, very close to the speed of light, time dilates, it stretches out for that thing, and space changes, space warps. And so actually what was a bag of marbles, which was like a sphere, flattens by a factor of 100. So it's just two pancakes that come flying together and smashing together. What goes in? 197 protons and neutrons, 197 protons and neutrons, they smash into each other, and what comes out are thousands of particles come flying out from that collision. All that energy goes into creating new forms of matter, new kinds of matter, different things that hadn't existed there before. You're not just getting out what you put in, you're getting out a zoo of different kinds of particles that come streaming into the detector. And one thing which is quite interesting about this that a lot of people wouldn't expect is you get as much antimatter coming out as you do matter.
Now, I knew we were going to talk about antimatter, which is slightly more difficult to understand than matter.
Yeah.
So let's just take a second to give an idea what antimatter might be. You had two ideas to help explain it.
Mathematically, antimatter comes from the idea that if you had a simple equation, now, okay, this is going to be a bit of math, but it's not that complicated. It's like if you took like m squared equals 1, there would be two ways to have that equation work. M could be minus 1. Minus 1 times minus 1 would give you a positive. Or it could be plus 1. Plus 1 times plus 1 would also give you positive 1.
Same answer, different input.
Yeah, so the equation would be satisfied by either one of those. Somehow in our universe, all we see is one of the answers. But when we collide these things together, we see both answers. And so that's one of the mysteries of physics, which we don't understand, which is incredibly fundamental, is why are we made out of matter instead of antimatter? So for physicists, actually, you know, when you talk to people, they often, you know, think, oh, antimatter, that's so bizarre. Like, but as a physicist, after you've been thinking about it for a long time and for many years, you start thinking, matter, that's so bizarre. Like, why is it all matter? And it's like, there should be antimatter. What happened to it? Right? And so that's one of the questions that we would like
and
to
try to answer.
And if
matter meets antimatter, yeah, it'll just go poof.
It'll disappear. And there's another way to think about antimatter, which you could think about it as, like, let's say you had a pool of water, and you took a little piece of that water, a drop of it, and you moved it up here. Okay, now you have a drop, and you have an empty space. You could call this a drop, and you could call that an anti-drop. Okay, that's also another very valid way of thinking about what antimatter is. If you took that drop, and you let that drop and anti-drop come together, it would all disappear. Antimatter would annihilate with matter, and it would completely disappear. So one little bit of trivia. Just down the road from here, the relativistic heavy ion collider created the largest antimatter nucleus which has ever been observed. So yay for
applause.
that's not for me, by the way. I just would want to mention that this facility is, you know, has thousands of scientists working at it. 5,000 people working on one experiment, 5,000 people working on 500 working at, you know. It's just, whatever, it's like nothing. It's 500 and 500.
What's another zero?
And then, yeah, exactly. And and then several hundred who just operate the facility to get these collisions to occur. So it's a lot of people that work together in concert to try to make this stuff work.
Okay, so now we've got this explosion.
Yes.
We've got this zoo of all these incredible things. This explosion is hot.
Yes. The explosion is actually the hottest thing that humans have ever created. Okay, it's 250,000 times hotter than the center of the sun.
That would be 5 trillion degrees Fahrenheit, approximately.
Centigrade.
Centigrade.
Don't know it's only off by a factor of 2, so I don't know.
It's pretty hot.
2.5 trillion. It's hot, yeah.
It's hot, but it's small.
That's right. It's very small. So these things, you know, of course, they're only the size of the nucleus. So you have the collision, and this thing just flies apart, and it very quickly expands and cools. And so it's that collision region, that blob is like, that little speck is 1/1,000,000,000 of a meter across. And it lives for a very, very short amount of time.
How short?
1/1,000,000,000 of a second. That's short. So it's very short, exactly. Thank you.
It is. Enjoy life while you can, right?
Now, exactly. So one way to think about this is that, you know, if you compare 1 second like that to the age of the universe, the difference between that and the age of the universe is smaller than the difference between that 1 second and how long this little speck lives, okay? I don't know, there's so many analogies, you could just like go off on them, but.
But there was a, when you identified this speck, when you had the speck, you have the temperature, you know it's very hot because of the color it emits?
Yeah, that's right. So one of the simplest ways that you can measure a temperature, so you all know that if you go up to a stove and it's glowing red, you shouldn't touch it. You know that if it's glowing white, you really shouldn't touch it, okay? And so the color of the particles that are being emitted, in this case, the stove, it's light that's being emitted, so the particles are what are called photons. That tells you how hot it is. The hotter it is, it's pretty simple. The hotter it is, the more kinetic energy there is bouncing around in all the molecules, so the faster, the higher energy photons you can create. The same thing happens in this. So we can look at how fast the particles are that are coming out from the collision, and from that, we can figure out what the temperature was. You can also look at the different ratios of particles. You'll end up with more massive ones if it's hotter. You know, lots of different ways of looking at it.
So this collision happens, and the gluons, rather the quarks, and the gluons kind of go their separate ways.
No, absolutely not.
No, I thought they did.
Exactly.
I thought the gluons kept the quarks together.
No, that's...
Okay.
You know, the way that I would explain it is in Star Wars, you had a lightsaber fight, right? And so this is a fight between two things emitting light where you're having swords. But photons, light, doesn't interact with other light. That's why this thing shines on me and that thing shines on me, and they just add up. They don't like bounce off of each other. Gluons are completely different. They actually interact with each other. So a lightsaber doesn't make sense. A gluon saber does. So actually the fact that these gluons interact with each other and interact with the quarks means that when you try to pull apart two quarks, there's a band between them of gluons that are going back and forth that create this rubber band. And you'd have to put in an infinite amount of energy to get to be able to separate them. Okay? And of course, it's easier to, instead of separate them, this is kind of quantum mechanical weirdness, to instead of separating them as you pull them apart, to create a quark and an anti-quark. So just like that bubble that you created on the surface of the water, we have a bubble going that way and a, you know, a blob going that way. It's easier to do that and pop that out of the vacuum, what we call the vacuum, which is not really a vacuum, to pop those things out. Now you have these two things going off. So those quarks never get out on their own. They're always stuck together.
In some sort of
something else.
Plasma, though, isn't that ultimately?
In what we would call a particle. But what we can do to liberate them, because we're all against, like, you know, restrictions.
Right.
We're just crazy like that. What you can do to liberate them is if you make something that's dense enough and hot enough, then instead of them being bound together in these particles like protons that make up what we are, bound together in these little blobs, you can create something that's so hot and so dense that it's like a sea, like a seething soup of quarks and gluons. And that is what the entire universe was made of at 1 microsecond after the Big Bang.
Quark,
and that's
gluon,
what we make.
Plasma.
Exactly.
What it's kind of called, which is
yes.
which is an ooze, it's a liquid.
It turns out that it's a liquid, which was a surprise.
Not a gas, which we would have
not
imagined the universe at that time
exactly.
was some gaseous creation. No,
that's
it's
right.
a liquid.
It turns out to be a liquid.
Now,
which was
when
surprising.
We think liquid, we have liquid on our table, wine, beer, water. Is it that kind of liquid?
Similar. You might think of, let me tell you one thing that which was really shocking about it, was it turned out that it's a liquid that flows with almost no viscosity at all. And so it's a little bit like water, except better, because it has less viscosity.
Viscosity
like
meaning?
No, it's even better than beer, if that's possible. Better than this beer, that is possible.
Viscosity meaning what, just so we know our terms?
Meaning, if you think of honey, honey has viscosity. If you stuck it between your hands and you move this hand, you would feel this hand pulling against that one because it's sticky. That means you have a high viscosity. If you moved this hand and you didn't feel anything at all on the other hand, that would be a low viscosity.
So water would have a very low viscosity.
Water would have a very low viscosity, but not nearly as low as the viscosity which we found that this fluid has. This
almost
quark,
as if it's
plasma.
Not there.
Almost
our tradition.
Exactly. But it is there. It's extremely dense and extremely heavy, but it flows almost, you know, perfectly. It just does whatever it wants to. It's just great.
So this. So my understanding was this was a tremendously significant finding.
Oh yeah.
At RIC. Why? Why
yeah,
was
absolutely.
This so significant?
One, it was shocking. It told us that we didn't understand at all the matter that can come about by putting together lots of quarks and gluons. So there's something called emergent phenomena. The idea of that is that, and that's the whole reason why we do what we do. The idea is that you can't predict what water is going to be like by just studying H2O. Okay? Just having that molecule and knowing everything about that molecule doesn't tell you that it freezes, that it boils, that it turns into steam. It doesn't tell you what water is like. All of those things emerge from putting billions and billions of molecules together. So we're doing the same thing. We're putting, you know, thousands and thousands of these quarks and gluons together and trying to see the properties that emerge from that. And this is completely new and fundamental because we're doing it on a level which has never been done before, down at the scales where you're inside the nucleus. And that is, you know, telling us what the universe was like. One of the surprising things was that it actually turned out that string theorists who are trying to create a theory which is even more fundamental than the theories that I'm talking about, they have certain mechanisms for doing calculations, and they found that their calculations agreed with some of what we were observing, which means that our facility, besides creating the hottest temperatures humans had ever created, besides creating the heaviest antimatter nuclei that had ever been created, besides creating the most perfect fluids known in nature, it was also the first facility where string theory was compared to nature in a way that could actually be confirming of whether those calculations made sense or not.
Now, there's another facility that
yes.
most of us have heard about in Europe. Briefly, what's different about
yeah.
what they're doing over there in Europe and what you're doing here?
So,
and how do they complement each other? Because I know you work together as well.
Yeah, that's right. It's very complementary. In fact, they do something almost exactly what we're doing. Sometimes, like for 1 month out of the year, they collide heavy ions too at a higher energy. Their energy is something like 200 times higher than the energy at RIC because they have a bigger accelerator. But it turns out that our facility sits right at the transition region. So the collisions that we can create can go just above the transition, where quark-gluon plasma freezes into protons and neutrons, and just below the region. So that's the most interesting region.
Now, when you say
be.
That transition region,
yeah.
you're talking about, go back to the Big Bang and those microseconds
yeah,
on either
right.
side
so,
of it.
So what happened at 1 microsecond after the Big Bang was you had this quark gluon plasma, which we're talking about, and as the universe expanded and cooled, it got to the point where you didn't have the density and the temperature necessary for these quarks and gluons to behave the way that we're talking about. And they had to bind together into what are called composite particles. So they had to condense. They had to freeze into these, you know, condensed particles, which are like the protons and neutrons that make up our nuclei. So inside of us are all the little bits and things that condense from that quark gluon plasma. That's what makes us, right? So not only are we, as Carl Sagan said, you know, stardust, we are also quark gluon plasma debris. I don't know.
Not Joni
nearly
Mitchell
as,
said we
not
were stardust.
Nearly as poetic. But did she? I didn't
yeah,
know.
Yeah, I think that's a lyric from one of her songs.
Yeah. So there's that transition that occurred at 1 microsecond where you went from this quark gluon plasma to everything else.
And this that's perfect what I mean, liquid.
This perfect
that
liquid.
That you created.
That's right. Which transitions. So you can think about it as, you know, there's... this is not a perfect analogy, but you can think about it as the point where you go from boiling water and you have steam to cooling down to below where you have water. We're looking
just
at that transition.
Just that point.
Yeah, that's right. We map right there. And then by colliding at higher energies, you can go a little bit further, but not much. Not much.
There was stuff that happened before the time that you can travel to.
That's right.
In another microsecond or millionth of a billionth.
Yeah.
We haven't gotten that far back
yet.
Yeah,
there's a lot of really important stuff. So, for example, the answer to why we are more matter than antimatter, physicists believe that it happened at a transition that happened even before. Now, what's challenging is that we can't recreate that phase transition because you would have to build an accelerator which was roughly, you know, the size of the solar system to get the energies, you know, unless there's some completely transformative technology which allows it, which, you know, you never rule out. But it might be that we are at a unique time in human history where we are just at the point that we're able to probe one of these phases that existed in the early universe. And the next phase up is way, way back there. It's really, really far to try to get to, and it's not likely that you'll actually recreate it. You can learn about it by breaking down the protons and going inside deeply inside them, but you won't actually recreate that matter. And that's really the difference between what the LHC, the Large Hadron Collider, was designed to do versus what we were designed to do. We were designed to actually recreate that matter. They're trying to look at it in a different way by taking protons, which are smaller things, still very complicated objects, like I mentioned, you know, they're the debris that came out of this quark gluon plasma, and smashing those protons together. A lot of them think we're crazy because we're taking this big mess, like this giant, you know, 197, this big balls of marbles and smashing them together. They're like, what are you going to ever learn by
you're creating too much
that?
Of a mess?
Yeah, it's a huge mess. It's like you know, it's going to be a complete, you know, chaos, and you won't know what's. But the idea that we're exploring is that when you make things complicated enough, at some point they become simple again, and that's when you recreate something, and all of a sudden you can start talking about matter as like, hey, this is a thing. It has a temperature. It has a viscosity. So you're not talking about the little individual particles inside of it. You're talking about something that came about from it.
I asked Paul earlier when he talks about this stuff, because we're all trying to get our heads around this. We're all trying to understand it. We're trying to visualize it, perhaps.
Me too.
So what are you seeing? What are you seeing? Are you seeing mathematical equations? Are you seeing a computer screen? Are you somehow imagining it in a physical realm? And then the second part of that question is, take me back then to the young boy who was looking up at the stars in Oregon, and how you got here from there.
So the age. So the question about, you know, what do I see? So, you know, there are people who are very mathematically gifted. They tend to become theoretical physicists, and they tend to describe nature through equations. And they're very good at taking a vision of what something might be happening and putting it down into an equation which they can then manipulate and learn something new about, and they can make predictions based on it. I'm not that. I'm
only got a B in math, by the way.
Exactly. I got a B.
So it's unbelievable.
My first physics class, I got a C. I went from like C to B, I got an A minus, and I'm like, hey, it's not bad. Maybe this will work. But in any case, so for me, when I'm visualizing, when I'm making measurements, when I'm trying to figure things out, I just like reasoning things through in my head in terms of how things spatially sort of make sense, you know, and how, and you visualize. And you start to absorb physics ideas, like even bizarre ideas about quantum mechanics. You start to try to at least convince yourself that you have some understanding of what you might expect. And then you try to invent measurements, which you think, based on your intuition, will tell you something interesting. And then you go to theorists and say, does this make sense? Can you predict, will this be something interesting? So that's what I do. And it's a particularly difficult to do that, for example, at the Large Hadron Collider, where you have these very simple collisions, but it's easier to do that where you have these big complicated collisions. It's like a sandbox where we all get to get in and play and figure out what's going on. So.
Is the real mind blower for you that you can actually measure these things, that you can actually find, that you have detectors and measurements? I was lucky enough to visit it the other day, part of the collider, and it is the most phantasmagoric collection of plumbing I've ever seen in my entire life.
Absolutely. This was how I started doing this. So you asked about like when I was a kid looking up at the sky. So the original thing that got me interested in physics was really the cosmos. It was looking out into the night sky and saying, like, what on earth is out there? And I was the youngest in my family, and I had, so other people in my family could tell me things like, oh, that's a star, and it's that far away. And it just, like, the more I learned, the more, mind blown I was. And so I wanted to try to understand that. And so that got me into astronomy. And then, an astronomy professor of mine said, well, if you want to become an astronomer, you have to understand physics. And actually, in physics, you're studying the smallest things. So another mind-blowing thing is that by studying the smallest things in nature, you can learn about something at such a huge scale. But in any case, how I started working at RIC was actually visiting a facility very similar to the facility that they have here. It was deeper underground. It was in Germany. And so you walked into this little shed. Like somebody swiped their ID and we walked in, you walked down these stairs and then you walked up to this edge and you looked down at this huge pit. There's this massive detector, which is like, as you said, like all this plumbing and electronics, the size of like a huge building, a four-story house. And I just like, my heart kind of stopped. I'm like, I don't care what they're doing. I want to do this. It's like, that's what I want to do. And that's how I got into, started learning about particle physics and started trying to, figure out what I could do and how I could contribute to the whole picture.
We were also talking before about the phenomenon of you being aware at some moment in time, some point of time, the point of discovery, of observation, that you are, at that moment, maybe the only person on Earth who kind of has seen that or understands that.
Yeah.
And how that is the moment of triumph, I suppose.
I'm a big mouth. So it's like, as soon as that happens, it's amazing. It's like, it starts with being confused. Being confused, which can be frustrating, but at the same time, you're confused and it can cause all this anxiety but excitement at the same time. Like, you observe something. It's like, that doesn't make sense. Why is that? And it will keep you up at night. And at least for me, I don't know if it keeps you up. For me, it's like, I cannot stop thinking about this. Like, as I'm driving home, it's like, why is it like that? And you know that you're on to something because it doesn't make sense, and it's telling you something. It's trying to, nature is like tapping you on the shoulder saying, hello, you haven't figured me out, and it's driving you crazy. But then when you finally get to a point where you make this little leap and you figure something out, and all of a sudden you realize, everything falls into place, and you understand something in a way that nobody else has before. That's a really special, special moment, which is what drives, I think, scientists to do what they do. It's a high. It really is. It's a high like anything else that, running a marathon or all these other things that can get you excited. And like I said, when that happens to me, some physicists are very pragmatic. They write it all down, make sure they have their paper published. I run down the hallway and I'm like, hey, I figured something out. I knock on the door, like, say, oh, look at this. I can't not. It's like,
quite literally, what you're discovering, what you're witnessing, is small beyond small, small beyond human comprehension. And yet, you've said this is, and we can't imagine exactly how and why it is important. You said this stuff is important. It's more important than politics or the presidential election or, you know, Beyonce or you name it.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's bigger.
Beyonce?
Or Miley Cyrus.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, yes.
And it's because it's, well, you describe it. What?
It's because, one, you're trying to answer some of the deepest, most fundamental questions in nature. And, you know, this is something that if you can contribute to this, if you can move human knowledge just that one bit, it's never going to go away as long as we exist. It's a contribution that is laying a groundwork for every generation that comes after us. And that's very different than, you know, I don't know, becoming the richest person in New York or do, you know, whatever little thing is happening now that's going to be forgotten 100 years from now, if not 100 years from now, 1,000 years from now. These things are going to last as long as we last, which hopefully is a long time.
We're living in a, seemingly, in a relatively anti-science age, at least politically, in this country.
Yeah.
How do you resolve that with what has become your life's calling? And
I care very much about the lessons that we can get from science and how helpful that can be to everything. Science is not any of this that I'm talking about. It's not the facts that I'm telling you. It's not those things. Science is a process and a way of thinking. It's an interrogation of reality. It's a setting aside of your ego and your ideology and what you think makes sense. Setting that aside and being willing to say, you know, I might be wrong. What if I am wrong? How would I know if I'm wrong? Does this really make sense? Are my assumptions really valid? If we could do this more in society, in all realms of society, we would be way, way better off. How many what are called zombie ideas are out there which ruin our lives? Well, okay, our lives aren't so bad, honestly. Let's not get too pessimistic. This is, you know, probably the best time to be alive in the history of the universe. And so, you know, but, you know, things could be better. That's, I think, the biggest lesson from science that everybody could take is that, you know, look, be like this. This is the way humans can be. Just to give you an example, 2,000 years ago, somebody had the wacky idea that if somebody's sick, you could cut them open and bleed them and that they would feel better, okay? Crazy idea. And sometimes it actually does work, and it's actually still used. But for the most part, it doesn't work. In fact, the first president of the United States may have died because of bleeding. I don't know if everybody knows that. George Washington went out on his horse. He was out in the cold. He got a throat ache from a very serious infection in his throat. And they bled something like one-third of his blood from him. And then he died. Shocking. After all the treatment they could give him. That idea persisted for 2,000 years because nobody ever thought to check it. There are so many things like that. The idea that if you took two things that had exactly the same mass or that had different masses and dropped them, the one that had more mass would fall faster. That actually turns out to not be true. It's kind of intuitively seems like it should be, but it's not. If you do the test, it's not. That idea lasted for something like 2,000 years before Galileo said, oh, let me go to the edge of the Pisa, you know, the Leaning Tower of Pisa, which probably isn't really true, but and dropped it and checked. Nobody bothered to check. They just thought, oh, that makes sense. So just checking things. If we could just check things in society, you know, we would learn a lot, and we would kill all these zombie ideas.
No zombie ideas tonight. Let's thank Paul very much. So we have some, thank you. We have some thank questions.
You. What was there before the Big Bang? How did the Big Bang get started? And how long did it take the universe to go from the size of a golf ball to the size of our solar system?
No idea. And a very short amount of time. So this is this is one of the frontiers of human knowledge. There's hope that we'll figure these things out. But as things are now, you know, everything that I was talking about creating this stuff relies on something called the standard model. which is, you know, it's the recipe of the universe. It's what the universe is made of plus the way those things interact. So it's like a recipe, ingredients plus what you do with them. If you start pushing that too far back in time, eventually it breaks down. We don't know. So once you get to beyond this golf ball, no idea. It might not have, it might have lasted forever past that. It's completely open to speculation. The time it took to go from the golf ball to something the size of a solar system, that was a little bit under a microsecond. It was very fast. And that's why when you look out at the night sky, if you have X-ray eyes, or if you can, you know, not X-ray eyes, but if you have microwave eyes so that you can detect the cosmic microwave background radiation with your eyes, or if you just measure it with a telescope, it's so smooth. It's extremely smooth because everything got stretched. Whatever shapes you had before got stretched to billions and billions and billions of times larger, so that it became very smooth.
You talked about this massive collision taking place, and I think the term you used was creating a zoo of particles and so on. I'm just wondering how predictive that is. If you do it over and over again, do you get the same zoo, or do you get the Bronx Zoo and the Washington Zoo? What happens?
Every zoo is different. Every single one is different because there's lots of fluctuations. You know, quantum mechanics is things are popping in and out. So what's predictive is that you can predict the averages. And this is one of the ways that we figure out what's actually going on in those collisions is, you know, we kind of glossed over the fact that, you know, we talked about colliding these things. We actually have about 50,000 of those collisions happening every second. Okay, so we can study many, many of them. Okay, and so we average over all of those and we figure out average values of those. And then we look for fluctuations in them as well. And of course, there's lots of fluctuations telling us that they're all different. But, you know, the universe, the way that we understand the universe is we look out and there's you know, billions and billions of photons coming from every tiny little point in the sky that we look at. And so we can figure out these temperatures and the fluctuations and everything. These things, there's only a few thousand particles coming from each one. So if you only had one, you wouldn't be able to say very much. But we have billions of them. So it becomes a really big data problem too, by the way. We collect petabytes of data every year. Petabytes, that's millions, millions of terabytes. Millions. It's thousands of terabytes.
I know that the funding for this research is very expensive, billions and billions of dollars, and it comes from governments.
Right.
And I'm suspicious of governments. And do they want to use some of this research to make bigger and better weapons?
There is some research which is done by what's called DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Project. The stuff that I'm working on at Brookhaven has is funded through the Department of Energy as part of their Office of Science, which is really dedicated to just allowing scientists to do fundamental research at one level. And they also do practical research as well. For example, at Brookhaven we have a facility where you can take light and you can, you know, very high energy photons and shoot it inside the atoms, and you can study how molecules are changing in time. So you can, for example, look and see what's happening in a battery and how to make batteries last longer. And so in terms of nefarious things, I wouldn't
say there's none, because you know it's a responsibility. As you learn new things, there become, you know, possibilities,
and we saw this in the 1940s with the nuclear bomb. Yeah, and so as soon as you opened up the possibility of understanding, you open up opportunity, and you open up, and that opportunity gives you power, which one has to be responsible about. The one thing that I would say is, this kind of science is actually bipartisan. As much as, you know, I won't tell you my political leanings, although you might be able to guess, but it's actually on both sides of the aisle. People in government, for the most part, understand that this stuff is extremely important. And that's one thing I do is we go to D.C. and we talk to our representatives about, you know, why we do what we're doing and why it's important to fund it.
And, you know, they do get it. They do understand it. And what it is that, you know, that you have to keep this fundamental research, it feeds into things that become important. You don't know when it's going to become important. It might be 1 year, it might be 10 years, it might be 100 years. But things like, you know, one of the famous examples is GPS. So GPS relies very in detail on the calculations of the general theory of relativity. If you didn't have that, you would be off by, you know, a long distance, and you wouldn't be able to find your way to wherever you're trying to go. That general theory was, you know, it was pure fundamental research. It wasn't to invent the GPS. And there's many, many examples like that. And people in government do get that. But it's also important that the public, and this is, are open and not, you know, that you're willing to learn things. There's a lot of people who get ideologies and ideas in their mind, and that might push them in particular directions about things. You really, when dealing with science, you have to be open to the ideas, and you really have to study things and understand and be willing to be proven wrong and to be willing to listen, which is we're not always that good at. You guys accepted, by the way.
These collisions that you do they occur in like larger scale in nature and stars?
They do, actually, yeah. Not in stars so much, but there's very, very high energy particles which are coming from cosmic processes, which are not fully understood. Like, how do you accelerate things with these energies? And they're striking the moon, they're striking the atmosphere. They're called cosmic rays, and they're hitting us right now. Like, if you put a detector to detect cosmic rays, you would hear, like, flip, flip, flip. And some of them are more powerful than the collisions that we study. People study those as well. The problem about trying to learn very much from them, because that's originally how we discovered many particles, was from these. We went up to the tops of mountains, and we put detectors up there, and we started seeing particles coming in. We didn't know what any of these particles were. I talked about a zoo. It was like an elephant and a giraffe. And I said, well, I've never seen an elephant or a giraffe before. So we saw all these things coming down. They were coming from these cosmic rays. But they only happen, you know, a few times per second. You have no control over where they're going to happen. So it's very difficult to do, like, real science based on them. So we've engineered these machines to essentially create these beams which give us collisions like those.
So the little golf ball went from a golf ball to the size of the solar system in a microsecond?
It did, yeah.
Way faster than the speed of light, right?
Yes, that's crucial.
So what does that do to relativity?
So the difference is that relativity is telling you that nothing can travel faster than the speed of light. This is telling you that space expanded faster than the speed of light. Nothing in that space was moving faster than the speed of light.
As a representative of the journalists, by the way, we are not against zombie ideas. It gives us something to write about every day. So
I had no idea zombies were going to come into this discussion.
Zombie candidate, yes.
Quick question. Would it make a difference if I was made out of antimatter?
If everything was antimatter, you wouldn't be able to tell the difference, okay? But if you were antimatter and you were matter,
that wouldn't be good.
That would not work.
And we don't know why there's more matter than antimatter, right? We still don't understand that fundamental question.
We have ideas, and some of those ideas are probed in the collisions that we look at by analogy. Because one idea is that there was a phase transition that occurred, which, you know, the idea of, if you think about a phase transition, imagine you had a swimming pool with a bottom that went like this, and then you lowered the water. At some point, you could have a ball that was sitting exactly in the middle of the pool, and as the water went down, it would come down. At some point, once you get to that bottom, it's got to go one way or the other. And so that kind of process can give you an asymmetry like this, and we can probe those kinds of processes at the phase transition we create. But that's not the phase transition that might have created matter versus antimatter. That happened way before. So it's still an open question.
Last question's about aliens, okay? So we have to ask a question about aliens. So let's talk about the implications for life elsewhere. And your assessment, 1 to 10, that there's intelligent life elsewhere in the universe, with 10 being the highest level of certainty. I mean, how do you feel about that?
First of all, could you quantify... Do you consider us intelligent life? That's the first thing. It's
like, I refuse you that.
And if you do.
If you do.
For purposes of this discussion, let's say yes. Yeah. Okay.
Then, this is just me. Yeah. But you know, of course, one of the most, one of the awesomest things that's happened is the discovery of that really most stars do have planets circulating. And I cannot imagine that we are unique. Let me just tell you one reason why that is. So I would say like 9.999. I would say very highly likely. Another thing to think about, like 13.8 billion years, some people think that's a long time. But if you think about it, the Earth is 4.5 billion years old. So the Earth has been around for a third of the age of the universe, which means that the Earth and life on Earth developed almost as soon as life could have developed. Because first you had to have stars that collapse and created all of the heavier elements which are needed to create us. And then as soon as you did that, you had to create another solar system which allowed us to condense on the surface of it. And it's like, as soon as that was possible, it happened, in our case. Almost as soon as it was possible. So I can't imagine that it's not happening elsewhere.
I want to again thank Paul for a mind-bending and fascinating.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, everybody, for coming.
And on behalf of the Alder Center and Stony Brook University, this has been another Science on Tap. We'll see you in a couple weeks.
Thank you so much.